chemical insult be seen on an MRI?
Well, you can't tell a chemical insult from anything else, for sure. However, the chemicals tend to have arachnoiditis or have nerve pumping over a wide area, because what happens, it's not just trauma, it's a fluid that's gotten into the spinal fluid and caused toxicity maybe over a span of 2 or 3 inches to where, let's say, you have a tarlar cyst that's a half an inch, and the arachnoiditis stays a half an inch in that case, but with toxicity, toxic chemicals, that I've seen cases in which I think we have as long as 6 inches of arachnoiditis. And most of that, was, we believe, was chemical. So the only way we can suspect it was chemical is when it's over a, it's got a long length to it in, on the MRI.
Okay. Interesting. Wow. What can patients do on their own to decrease inflammation in the spine?
What can they do on their own?
Yes.
The first thing that they should do is go down to the health food store and start getting some chemicals and some supplements, whatever their pocketbook can afford, to get started. The number one thing I tell them to buy is pregnenolone. You can buy it over the counter. You can usually get a 30 or 50 milligram tablet and take some of that.
Okay.
Another thing that we think gets into the spinal cord, curcumin's a good one, white willow bark, serrapeptase, any of your natural herbal anti-inflammatory agents, they should start taking, okay?
Okay.
And this is what I recommend. Start trying to identify something that really helps. One good anti-inflammatory agent that you never hear much about is boswellia. Now, boswellia is actually a famous compound that was frankincense in the Bible that the three wise men brought to the Christ child. And so in ancient times, boswellia was called frankincense. And it's still good. And it's still out there for sale. And so these things, every patient with RSD, Lyme disease, post-stroke pain, anybody who's got an inflammatory condition that affects the spinal cord or the brain needs to start trying some of these natural pain relievers and anti-inflammatory agents. They're not going to work for everybody, but if you go shopping and try 2 or 3, you'll find 1 or 2 that help you. And you can go ahead and use that right along with the prescription drugs you get from your physician.
Absolutely. Great advice. Can mild scoliosis become worse with age?
I guess you better repeat that one. I didn't quite understand it.
Mild scoliosis. Can it become worse with age? Can it develop into arachnoiditis?
Yes. Scoliosis is one of the diseases that can be chronic. And, of course, think about this now. Those nerve roots are hanging straight down in fluid.
Mm-hmm.
If your spine is crooked, you're going to bend some of the nerve roots onto each other. Now, when they're bent onto each other, it causes compression and friction. And you do that long enough, pretty soon you've got inflammation. You get enough inflammation, pretty soon you've got adhesions. So people with scoliosis, even mild scoliosis or kyphoscoliosis, need to do a lot of stretching. There's nothing better than just stretching, I call it reach for the sky. You have to stretch out to keep the spinal fluid moving and to stretch out the spinal cord. So scoliosis patients need to diligently exercise some every day. I mean, they can sit there and reach for the sky when they're riding in an airplane or in a car. So these things are simple, but they are helpful, and they must be done to try to avoid arachnoiditis.
Exactly. As far as that list that you had just given of what people should go and get at the store, can you email that to me so we can put it up onto our website?
It's in the new handbook.
Awesome.
And I'll be able to send that to you within 48 hours.
Great. Okay. And what kind of provider specializes in arachnoiditis? Is there anyone in particular?
Well, as far as I know, I'm the only person on this planet who claims to specialize in arachnoiditis. And I still treat other kinds of pain, but I have dedicated a certain amount of my practice to arachnoiditis, and I'm letting people know about it because doctors, when they hear of something new, they want to kind of know if somebody else is also doing it. So I'm letting people know that I'm doing it, and they can do it too. But at this time, no, I wouldn't be able to give you any. I've got some doctors around the country who are starting to take patients. I've also got some nurse practitioners around the country who are starting to take patients, and they're doing a darn good job. And I've got a few, and it seems like every month we add a couple more. So I'm very positive and very optimistic that within a year, we're going to have a lot of doctors and nurse practitioners around the country.
Great news. Wow. Do you think that you can see arachnoiditis up to a year or longer after you've had a damage to your spinal cord or the dura that...
Absolutely. In other words, this helps for somebody who's even had it 20 years, 10 years. In other words, we can do something with everybody. So nobody should have the idea that they've had it too long or it's too severe to get some help and benefit from some help. That's just not the way it works. Okay? We can help everybody. It's an inflammatory disease. I mean, we found this out, for example, with rheumatoid arthritis. You may have had it for 20 years, but we can still help you. The help may not be as good as if we had started when you had it only 1 year, but nevertheless, you don't want to let the longevity hold you back.
Absolutely. So you recently published an arachnoiditis bulletin, and arachnoiditis is no longer rare. And I was just wondering if you could touch on that really quick, and who did it go out to, and what are the key points that people should take away from that? I have it up on the computer screen now for people to
It has classically been considered a rare disease.
Mm-hmm.
But because the population is getting older, they have all of these predisposing risk factors, such as sedentary lifestyles and no exercise and excess weight. They're putting themselves more at risk. Procedures. Today, we've developed wonderful surgical procedures and other interventions for spine problems. The trade-off is that a certain percentage of those people who avail themselves of those procedures or surgeries are going to get arachnoiditis. And so it is causing arachnoiditis to go up in both incidence and prevalence in the population. There were only, between 1950 and 2000, there was only a few hundred cases reported in the whole country. Now we get a few hundred cases reported every couple of months.
Mm-hmm.
And so it is being recognized all the time.
Great. Thank you for explaining that bulletin. When I received it, I was like, oh, wow, this is very important information that needs to get out. So thank you so much for that. Back to really quick to the question on my screen's scrolling so fast. People are talking so much. I'm trying to find it. How long does it normally take to see arachnoiditis on an MRI? Can you see it right away? What's the most common amount of time?
Good question. You can't see it on an MRI for probably 10 days after the injury.
Okay.
Maybe 2 weeks, a couple of months in some cases. I've taken a look at some people who literally within the first week or 10 days after the injury,
mm-hmm.
and I have to really look hard and say, well, that's probably the injury site, but I can't be sure. So I think that you can start seeing it within around 10 days, but I've got to tell you, it's a little iffy. You can't be positive that's what you're seeing, but you can't see it immediately. It does take a few days before it shows up on an MRI.
Okay. And then another question that just came in was, what do you think about inversion tables to help exercise or stretch the spine?
I think inversion tables are great for some people. Now, first off, the person who's going to get on an inversion table needs to be pretty limber, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And they should be pretty nimble on their feet. Somebody who's got an awful lot of excess weight or some paralysis or weakness in their legs shouldn't try an inversion table. You've got to be pretty strong to use the inversion table correctly. And you want to use it when you have a trusted friend with you so you don't tip back too fast
Right.
And also, you don't want to do it very long. 3 minutes, 5 minutes. People get this idea that you should sit on that inversion table for 30 minutes or so. I don't buy that. I think it's a risk. I've seen people try to hang upside down and also be on the inversion table and try to do it too long and too vigorous and hurt themselves more than anything else. So I'm hesitant to recommend an inversion table to people because it's a little tricky to use. It can be beneficial, but you just remember, it's got to be done very lightweight, meaning 3 or 4 minutes, very little stretching to get started, and a person who better be pretty darn nimble and able to get off that thing pretty fast. So now that I've said that, if somebody really thinks the inversion table is good, fine, but I don't think you got to have an inversion table to get better. I think I want to make that clear. There are a lot of people who have tried to sell the inversion table as an essential treatment. It is not. You can accomplish the same thing with these other simple stretching exercises.
Okay, very interesting. And one of my last questions, I know of a patient who was paralyzed after a spinal cord stimulator implant surgery. Do you think that that could have been from arachnoiditis, or do you think that that just happened to be something that happened because of the spinal cord stimulator?
My guess is he already had some spinal disease or the arachnoiditis. They put the stimulator in, and they got it connected to the wrong nerves or relocated inappropriately. In other words, the stimulator didn't cause this. It probably accelerated it. And that's one of the risks that one takes when they decide to implant something. In other words, they're putting the implant in because they've already got a disease. And that implant may make that disease worse.
Right.
So, again, these things are risky. Today, I'll try to – I know we're getting close to the end here.
Yes.
But I'll repeat this and say it over and over. Today, it's not available in every community yet, but we're developing good treatment protocols. And the patients want to take advantage of that before you go off and try risky things like stem cells, intravenous infusions, inversion table, surgery and implants. These are risky things that shouldn't be done unless you've tried everything else.
Absolutely. Go with the least invasive.
Right. You got it. Absolutely.
Yes. Thank you so much for your time. I have information up. If people want to get a hold of you, they can check out your website, forresttenant.com.
That'd be fine, and they can also stay in touch with you. And then-